And so the king is dead. They've taken Charles the First, tried him in Westminster, paraded him in Whitehall, and in the cold January of 1649, we have cut off his head. Truly, it was a cause for rejoicing. Freedom from a king who would not listen to his parliament, a king who flung his people into civil war. Did we not surely celebrate his death? No, in truth we did not. For as we killed him, there was a great groaning among us. And we asked ourselves, is it truly finished now? And we said, what is this army that now strides across our land and would rule us with a rod of iron as unyielding as any scepter of gold? And in truth we wondered, did we fight for this? It was said that Cromwell would bring order and a calm recovery from the chaos of war. But now, pressed on all sides by a giddy, hot-headed multitude, he has withdrawn to the heights of kingship himself. He that was a Cambridge farmer is now become His Highness. He elevates himself from friends and enemies alike in the royal palace of Hampton Court. And when he holds audience with those who gave him power, he does it in the banqueting house beyond whose windows the king was killed. Cromwell is thus become a king in all but name, surrounded by the spectacle of monarchy. We might as well give him the crown, for too well have we made him play the role of king. Like my character of Thomas Palmer, many people were puzzled, perhaps even disillusioned, by the outcome of the Civil War, even those who'd won. And executing the king wasn't something they did lightly. Only 43 members of Parliament signed his death warrant. Few really imagined that the king would be killed. But the fact was there. The people of Britain had fought a civil war, had chosen their sides and taken their roles. And now, unlike my false whiskers, they were unable to peel them off again. Now the king was dead, they had all to come to terms with the consequences. So, as always happens, as people tried to understand the shocking events of war, they started to tell their version of history. It's something we've been doing ever since, in everything from television dramas like How We Used to Live to films like Cromwell. Some say that, in fact, Cromwell kept a low profile during the king's execution, that up to the very last minute, he tried to stop it happening. But you don't make strong drama out of low profiles.
We did not assassinate, nor was this thing done in a corner. It was done in the face of God and of all men. The office of king is now abolished. Long live Parliament. Long live the Republic.
Back in 1649, too, people, for a whole range of reasons, were giving their version of events. Take another look at this picture of Charles's death. Condemned for treason, he is executed under the just gaze of Oliver Cromwell. And now, look again. Almost the same picture, but printed back to front and saying very different things. Now the king is shown three times. He hands a memento to the Bishop of London. He dies on the block. And angels carry his soul to heaven. The king is already a martyr, a hero for his cause.
In other words, that picture is not a straightforward piece of historical reporting. It's a royalist version of history, drawn to make a point. You see, during and after the Civil War, people had their first real chance to practice mass propaganda, printing to persuade. There was very little censorship. There were plenty of printing presses. And the outcome was a misinformation revolution. And that, of course, is one of the reasons why it's quite difficult to understand what really happened. Our evidence comes from a war of words and pictures, where many of the words were lies, and many of the pictures were not there to tell the truth, but to persuade their viewers. They were party political broadcasts. Every version of history, then, is an interpretation, even when you're trying to tell the truth. I'll give you an example. Here we are at Oakwell Hall in Yorkshire. It's a location we use for our own interpretation of history, how we used to live. Oakwell Hall appears to be a pretty convincing piece of historical evidence. They even had a Civil War battle up the road. But can we really reconstruct its past with confidence? To get to the truth, we're obliged to peel away an awful lot of the present. So, Barry the sound man filters out the noises of today, hoping to discover the comparative silence of a world before the motor car. Colin the camera frames his picture only for the 17th century, trying to miss the tea rooms and the power lines. And gradually, we can guess at the way things were when Oakwell Hall hid peacefully at the end of a cart track amid fields and moors. But as each of us struggles to hammer out a true picture of history, how do we know that we might be getting it right?
I think you can't hope to get it absolutely right. You can only make inspired guesses based on really sound evidence. And I think the first-hand evidence, the letters, the diaries, the accounts, reports, it's like being a detective. You compile the evidence, and then there's a story emerging. Maybe what you're trying to prove has got a flaw here and there. But having not been alive at the time, how can you know that?
Sources are available to anybody, really. I research in books. I look at paintings, etchings, whatever's available of the time. This has been difficult in as much as the working people involved. There's not a great deal of visual information, because the only people who could afford to have their portraits painted to show what they looked like were obviously the rich people. And they were very stylized and very romantic, because they were always painted without a wrinkle and without a crease and looking absolutely immaculate. But that really probably wasn't the case, because we're talking days without washing machines and spin dryers and steam irons or whatever. People, I think, find the word fashion a rather frivolous and flippant term. But actually it isn't. It's how people lived, what their aspirations were, what their finances were, how they lived, where they lived. They wore thick clothes because they lived in a cold climate. They had very few clothes, or they had lots of clothes. It's the social history is very important, how people look, because now most people can get away with jeans and t-shirts, whatever an age, but that is very recent.
You look at today, and you look back at the 1640s, and you see that men and women haven't changed all that much when it comes to fighting for their principles. They may have had a lot of changes in their social condition, in their income, in the way that democracy works, but when they were fighting for their beliefs, they were quite recognisable as our forefathers.
In 1834, the Palace of Westminster was ravaged by fire. The Victorians rebuilt their parliament with a clock on top and Cromwell outside. The building he guards is Westminster Hall, which remarkably survived the fire. And it was under this medieval roof that King Charles was tried for treason. On the floor of Westminster Hall, a brass plate commemorates the trial of 1649. And surely here, amid the documents of time and within the walls of government, we might hope to uncover some historical truths. Curiously, though, it soon becomes clear that Victorian Westminster has its own version of the past, something which historian Sue Morris discovered with students from Thomas Tallis School.
Right, well, first we're going to look at this picture, which is on the way to the House of Lords. Is there anybody that you actually recognise in here?
Charles I.
Yep, Charles I up there, standing in the centre of the picture. What are the reactions of the people to seeing Charles there in that room?
Not very good, because They look sort of curious about why he's supposed to be there because the king's not allowed in the House of Parliament.
Yes, they are very curious, even angry. Now, what is it that he has done? Well, we have to look now at this person here. That person is the Speaker of the House of Commons, the person who actually controls the sessions. And maybe you can work out what he's doing from his position. You see, he's on his knees and he's bowing down, but what's he doing?
Stop.
Stop, yes. Now, what had happened was that Charles believed five members of Parliament were guilty of treason, so he came to the House of Commons to arrest them. And the Speaker is saying, no, in this room, I can't obey you, I obey them. Now, this is about the parliamentarians. Let's now go and look on the other side to a picture which is about the royalists. Right, well, this picture shows us an event which took place about 6 months later at Nottingham, and it's now a great event on the royalist side that we're looking at. Can you tell me who this is, who's in the centre of the picture? Yes.
Charles I.
That's right, right up there. This time he's got his arm in the air, he's very proud of himself. What are all these people doing?
They are his followers, they are saluting what he is saying.
That's right. Can you tell me what event is being shown, though? What's going on?
He's erecting his standard at Nottingham.
That's right, yes. Just up there, that great flag, great embroidered flag with the royal arms on it. Now, what does that mean? If you put up your standard, what is the implication?
When you erect your standard, it's meaning the king's declaring war on the parliament, which meaning he's willing to stand up for himself and what he thinks is best for the country.
That's right. Right, well, that introduces the two pictures. What we're going to do now is go off to somewhere quiet and start to think about whether these paintings can be any use as historical evidence for the Stuart period, given that they weren't even painted until 200 years afterwards. Okay?
I don't know whether they would have all brought their swords and things.
Yeah.
But they might have done to show how supportive they were.
Yeah.
I think the clothing is very reliable.
Yeah. You would have got that from
research,
sources.
Yeah.
And what Charles looked like, because that picture.
I don't really think that Charles in person would be there himself, and I think he would have got somebody else to sort of come and sort of rally them on.
This was a painting which had been, the Parliament had asked the man that painted this, Charles Cope. He was asked by the Parliament, so obviously it's going to be biased towards the Parliament.
Yeah.
But
it's coming from a 19th century mind rather than the 17th century.
This painting does seem to have a sort of like romantic touch to it, with the dog and the son of Charles I, holding on to his dad. But the background seems to be made up,
a bit fairy tale-like, really.
Somehow it doesn't seem so truthful, because the way the light's falling on his face kind of implies that he's a better person.
What could you use to research into what he looked like?
I expect there were paintings done.
Yeah.
In the time.
How could you research into who was there on that occasion, do you think?
There would probably have been records.
Could well have been, yes. Well, let's just see how you got on. Right. So how do you think they could have found out how Charles I looked?
Well, they could look at portraits that had been done when he was around, because at that sort of time, all the monarchy had portraits of themselves done. But they may be biased towards him, as he would be the one that would ask them to paint the portraits
exactly.
of him.
Yeah. Very good, yes. What about the building itself, though, that parliamentary room? Because as I told you, it was burnt down in 1834. It didn't exist when Charles Westcote came along. How would he have found out what the House of Commons looked like? Yes, again, pictures, yes. And I just happen to have one here, for instance. That was painted in 1794. If we look at the other one, what sort of things do you think the artist might have had to make up for the picture?
Background.
Why do you say that?
Because it looks kind of romantic and it just looks like made up.
Could the artist have gone to the place where the standard was raised?
Yeah, he could have, except especially after the Civil War, many things would be different and lots of things would have grown and been built, and especially if it's 200 years later.
That's right. Some parts are going to be the artist's interpretation. The way these people are standing, the way the light is falling, all of that is arranged by the artist so that you can understand the picture. But the amount of research he's done into the clothes, the costume, the event itself, is very helpful. And in a sense, he is as likely to be reliable on that as somebody 2 days later or ourselves today. The only other thing we have to bear in mind, though, is that a Victorian has selected this for us to look at because a Victorian person thought it was important.
Certainly, when the Victorians restored Westminster, they rebuilt it as a palace fit not only for a parliament, but also for a queen. This, for instance, is the royal robing room where the monarch dresses before opening parliament. And yet, on public display in this lavish hall of state is a grim document, the death warrant of Charles I. Here you may read the damning signatures of the king killers, the regicides. And here, by chance, we found another historical puzzle. Because when the curators produced the warrant for us to film, they noticed that not all the seals matched the signatures. Why did Oliver Cromwell place his seal against other names too? Whatever the answer, sometimes today's members of Parliament will swear to the importance of exploring history.
It's very important that everybody, particularly younger people, should understand the history from which we came. And in 1649, Britain became a commonwealth. It did away with the monarchy. It became a commonwealth, and during that short period, demands were made for equality, for justice, for elections, for the protection of the environment, which have influenced the thinking of every generation of people in this country since, although it's hardly ever referred to in the history books. You see, if you take the House of Commons, where I've been for 42 years, I went to the library not long ago, and I asked for some of the legislation of the Commonwealth. And the librarian said to me, "Commonwealth, Commonwealth, what do you mean?" Well, I said, "The period 1649 to 16." Oh, they said, "You mean the interregnum." So the only time that the Republic is mentioned is as an unaccountable gap between two kings. And when people talk about the Civil War and the interregnum, it makes it sound as if it was just a clash between Cromwell and the king. Whereas actually, it was the beginning of modern political developments.
Even within the seat of government, it seems, we'll find no absolute truth about the Civil War period. And here, it's easy to ignore what happened to ordinary people in the time between the kings. Because, though you'd never guess it from the propaganda, for many, the chaos brought the promise of welcome change. Though ridiculed by their enemies, many felt free from the oppression of state religion, free to worship or not in the way they chose. While some saw the coming of the kingdom of God, others, like the Levellers, saw a fairer earthly world in which wealth and property were shared. Women, too, glimpsed for a time an equality with men. And some people believed that the old ways of master and wife, lord and servant, had vanished with the king. They had tasted democracy, though Tony Benn believes both history books and Westminster hide the secret well.
I mean, I had a very expensive education. I heard about the Royalists and the Cavaliers as if it was a sort of World Cup football match. But nobody ever mentioned the Levellers to me. No, I think you have to recognize that democracy isn't something that dwells in this feudal palace where we're sitting. I mean, this has got nothing to do with democracy at all. Democracy is what people do for themselves. And when you look at the Berlin Wall coming down, that was without a vote in East Germany. When you look at the release of Nelson Mandela, there wasn't a vote in South Africa, but he had to come out. Because in the end, when people decide they want their rights, no government can stand against them. And that was a lesson that was learned in 1649. And ever since then, the British establishment have been very, very nervous of the British people. And whereas the French aristocracy went to the barricades and the guillotine, the British aristocracy have always retreated just in time because they don't want another 1649.
More than three centuries after the Restoration, the monarch still opens the People's Parliament. The traditions and the living issues of history remain our inheritance.